Good morning, brothers, sisters, visitors, and friends. Today's service will include the sacraments of water baptism and Holy Communion, along with reception of new members and dedication of an infant. Today's worship service is also observed as Caribbean Baptist Fellowship Sunday. I invite you to stand for the responsive call to worship. We have been claimed by the God who calls us children. As with the Israelites, God promises to pass with us through the water.
We will not fear, for God is with us.
The rivers shall not overwhelm us, for God is our guide and our protector.
Tested us are now the waters that wash us and nourish us.
Great is the fount of every blessing,
ever flowing, ever redeeming, ever claiming us as God's children.
Come, let us worship the God who washes us in grace. The hymn, To God Be the Glory. You may be seated. I invite you to join in our prayer of adoration and confession. Let us pray. From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are indeed amazing, God. Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, we gather here today because we adore you. We are truly in awe of all you have done, all that you're going to do, and all that you will do. Faithful God, you created our minds to grow in wisdom, our hearts to expand with love. You created our voices to sing your praises forever. We bring you our worship with joyful praise, turning to Jesus for grace and guidance. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that the fruit of the Spirit will abound in our lives. May we worship you today in spirit and in truth, and serve you in the example of Jesus. Faithful and fruitful God, you call us to follow you whatever the circumstance. Yet we confess that we prefer to remain where we are. You offer us new beginnings, yet we continue to make the same choices. Guided by our own desires, we make excuses for avoiding your challenge to change. We love with condition, we judge and condemn. We cast the first stone and keep the logs in our own eyes. We do not turn to you as a source of our healing. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us of our sin, and empower us to be imitators of Christ in love and service. Amen. We continue in prayer as we sit to sing Father God in Heaven.
Father God in Heaven, for you, all I owe.
able, I ask you to stand and join in our responsorial psalm, which is taken from Psalm 16. We'll read alternate verses. Please stand. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you.
As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom all is my delight.
Those who choose another God multiply their sorrows, their drink offerings of blood. I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips.
The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot.
The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me.
I keep the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved.
Therefore my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure.
For you do not give me up to shame, or let your faithful ones see the pit.
You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The Gloria.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. World without end. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. It is my utmost pleasure to, at this time, welcome you to our worship service for today. Thank you for joining in chapel, and we also extend a special welcome to those joining online. At this time, I would like to acknowledge anybody who is worshiping with us for the very first time. Great. So we have one person, and if there's anybody online, so if there's anybody else, we invite you to stand. Okay, and the ushers will give you a nice sticker. So if there's anybody online, you can also acknowledge in the chat. We invite all our new members, visitors, both in chapel and online. You can visit our website, BethelBaptistHWT.com, and you can click the prompt that says, I am new, and you'll fill out that form, and we will get in contact with you. We're very happy to have you. Thank you for choosing to worship with us today. We also extend a special welcome to the parents and family and friends of baby Jada Lee Nylorine Black, who are sharing with us for the dedication. So at this time, I'll highlight a few notices, and they're going to be projected. So as you know, during this service, we'll have baptism and reception of new members. The persons to be baptized, Candice Blake, Jacqueline Knight, and also Cara Joy Reed. Yes, you can clap. Okay, the Bethel Baptist Bereavement Support Group invites us to attend a special presentation on the topic, The Pathway of Healing and Victory in the Wake of Loss. So the presenter is Dr. Daniel Brown, a clinical psychologist, and this presentation will be held today at 6 p.m., the meeting ID and passcode, they're in the bulletin and it's also being projected. Another forum that's being held today by the Jamaica Baptist Historical Society, that one is under the theme, A Conversation About the Maroons. That also begins at 6 p.m. And the moderator is our own brother, Jeremy Taylor. And the presenter is Colonel Wally Sterling of the Moortown Maroons. That meeting ID and passcode is also in the bulletin. So there are a lot of activities today. Some that may take 10.59 seconds, we hope. So we ask that you join in, if able. So the healing ministry also wants to inform us that the Saturday clinic is almost back. So services here will resume on Saturday, July 2nd, from 9:30 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. So if you'd like to see the doctor Saturday, there is that option. Also, the COVID vaccination will continue on Saturdays at the clinic. So just to highlight the persons on our prayer list, we remember Deacon Lassine Wisdom Barnett and brothers Lance and Layton Wisdom and the rest of their family on the passing of a grand aunt, Lola McKinley. That funeral service is scheduled for Tuesday, June 28th at the Hope United Church. We also remember sisters Bethune and Jackie Morgan, the passing of their father, Mr. Aston Morgan. Funeral service Thursday, June 30 at 10 a.m. at the Amara Road Seventh-day Adventist Church. We also remember the family of our deacon, Sarah Newland Martin. Her service of thanksgiving will be held here at Bethel on July 2nd at 10 a.m. We remember the family of brother Sabana Foster, and details of that funeral service will be advised. In addition, Sister Lorraine Hardware on the passing of her husband, Brother Russell Hardware, and we remember Reverend Angela Morgan Allen, Othman Morgan, and Othniel Morgan on the recent passing of their brother and uncle, the late Mr. Colin Anderson. And also the members on our prayer list, Sister Paula Hutchinson, who is ill at home, Brother Webster Moore, who remains hospitalized at the Medical Associate Hospital, Sister Yvonne Blenman, who has been discharged from the hospital, and the husband of Sister Angela Morrison, Mr. Percival Morrison, who is recuperating at home. And this week, we're encouraged to pray for members and persons whose last name begin with the letter K. Okay, so at this time, we invite the parents and relatives of Jada Lee Black to come forward for the dedication.
Brothers and sisters, today we welcome Ms. Jody Ann Brown and family, along with sponsor, as she has come to give God thanks for the birth of her daughter, Jada Lee. She has come to seek God's blessing upon her and to dedicate herself to the high task of parenthood. We share in her thanksgiving and we acknowledge the claim of this child upon the prayers and the support of the church, both now and in the years ahead. We welcome Jada Lee as Jesus welcomed children, and we offer and affirm that it is the duty of parents and of church together to so show the love of God in their lives that in due time this child may come to confess faith in Jesus Christ for herself. Let's remind ourselves of the purpose of this act of dedication. First of all, we give thanks to God, who is the creator and the giver of life, for the creation and the birth of this child. Secondly, we shall pray for God's blessing upon the child. Thirdly, we shall ask Mother to declare her intention to bring up this child with love and care. And fourthly, acknowledging the sacred nature and the responsibility of parenting, we shall commit ourselves as parents and as church to work together to bring up this child in a manner that is pleasing to God. And we do so with the hope and prayer that in due time this child will make that personal surrender and confession of faith. Hear the word of God. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them. The disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them. Let us pray. Gracious God, we acknowledge that you are the creator of all, giver of all life, creator of all things. Joyfully, we acknowledge your goodness in all your creation. We thank you for the gift of life and for the hope, for the joy and faith that children often inspire within us. For the birth of this child, we are grateful. We see it as in accordance with your will and purpose. As together we participate in this act of dedication, may your Holy Spirit hallow the moment. May your will be done. May you be glorified. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Ms. Jody, I put this question to you and invite your response by saying, "I do." Do you acknowledge with thanksgiving the goodness of God in allowing you to bring this child into the world? Do you recognize the sacred responsibility that has come upon you with the birth of this child? And do you promise to order your life, your words, and your deeds so that this your daughter may have a good and wholesome environment within which to grow? And do you pledge to seek the help of the Church of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fulfillment of that responsibility? May the Lord grant you the grace to faithfully carry out the promises you have made this day. May God grant you joy, patience, love, and peace, and may His grace always envelop you. Members of the Bethel Baptist Church here gathered and in other places, do you, on behalf of the whole Church of Jesus Christ, undertake to be an example of the Christian faith, to offer instruction in the gospel of God's love, and to provide your support, prayer, and friendship for this child and this child's family. If this is your affirmation, please indicate by standing. Please sit and let us pray. Gracious God, again we thank you for the birth of Jada Lee. We are grateful that in your providence, in your care, and in your provision, you have given her to her family, community, and to this world. We continue to pray that your hand of blessing, of protection, of provision will always be available to her, and that the purpose that you have set for her life will be fulfilled, that you will protect her from anything or any situation that will seek to derail that purpose. And we pray that you grant to her family, those who will nurture her, the wisdom, the knowledge, the patience, the understanding to cooperate with you in the nurturing of this child. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for children and for what they mean to us, presenting us as both signs and servants of your kingdom. Bless this child and all children gathered in worship today and in other places. May you and your goodness always be available to them. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So at this time, I invite all children 10 years and under to come forward for prayer before we send you off to junior church. So 10 years and under. All right, good morning, everyone. But I should say good morning, boys and girls, right? Good morning. You guys are on summer holiday? Not yet. Okay. All right, so bow with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for providing persons with strong faith to reach the hearts of children. Children, as they seek direction and purpose. May these children gathered here recognize your power in their lives and choose to follow you. We thank you for each child and family represented here today. Continue to guide and protect them there, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. Enjoy junior church. Okay, this morning we have two passages of scriptures. The first, the Old Testament from Exodus 14, reading from verse 19 to 22. The New Testament reading comes from Ephesians 2, verse 19 to 22. The New Testament reading will be read by Miss Ikara Joy Reed, a member of the June birth month, and also one of our candidates for baptism today. Before the scriptures, we will sing, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet."
A lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid,
Exodus 14, reading from verse 19 to verse 22. Then the angel of God, who had been traveling in front of Israel's army, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood behind them, coming between the armies of Egypt and Israel. Throughout the night, the cloud brought darkness to the one side and light to the other side. So neither went near the other all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on the right and on their left.
Ephesians 2, verses 19 to 22, New International Version. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you are two being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, our preacher this morning is our own pastor, the Reverend Dr. Glenroy Lalor. I ask that you continue to bear him up in prayer as he prepares to proclaim the word that God has laid on his heart. Just before he comes, we will receive a special musical item from the adult choir.
Jesus Christ.
It is our prayer, the prayer of all of us, that God, by God's grace, will enable us to walk close with Him. Brothers and sisters, I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And today we are grateful to God that in God's wisdom and according to God's providence, prompted by the work of the Spirit, we will have an opportunity to witness the baptism of Candice Blake, Jacqueline Knight, and Cara Joy Reed. But we'll not only have an opportunity to witness their baptism, we'll have a chance to think about our own baptism, to review, reaffirm the vows we made at our baptism, and to receive a challenge if we have not yet been baptized. We pray for God's grace, God's goodness, to continue to be available to all of us. Let us pray. Grant, O God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together will truly be acceptable in your sight, because, Lord, you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I would like for us to think together for a few minutes on the words recorded for us in Ephesians chapter 2, from verse 19 to verse 21. You remember those words, "Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of the household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, and with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit." These words is seeking to describe this new community and the new reality of the Gentiles who had become Christians. In order to describe this new reality and to talk about this new community, a community where Jews and Gentiles, once enemies, are reconciled to God and to each other, a community where colonized and colonial masters are coming together as a part of this one community, in trying to describe this community, the writer of Ephesians, St. Paul, used images with which the people, those listening, those hearing, those reading his letters, were familiar. He tried to use these images to help them to understand, in order to illuminate and to clearly explain this new reality, where enemies are coming together in one community, where those formerly opposed to each other are coming together in this one living family. In trying to describe that, he used these very familiar images to those who were listening. He talked about, used alien, foreigners, and citizenship. These images are relevant to us this morning, as together we will put in narrative form the statements that will be made this morning by our sisters as they go through the water of baptism. I would like to summarize these statements made by St. Paul, recorded for us in Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 19 to verse 21. I would like to summarize it in a very simplistic way. I would like to summarize it in a way that hopefully will help us to understand the meaning of this very loaded statement that St. Paul offers. We are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens and members of God's household. Think about it. On one hand, foreigners and strangers, the before, and on the other hand, citizens and members, the after. The who you were and the who you are. This loaded statement that St. Paul offers with this multiple of images, I would like to summarize it in this very simplistic way. And the statement is simply saying to the community that was once divided along ethnic, economic, nationalistic lines, the statement is simply saying to all who felt that they were not on the in, they were rather on the out, the statement is simply saying to them that we belong. We belong. You are a part of. This is your place. You have a privilege bestowed on you by the grace of God. Hear the words again. You are no longer foreigners. You are no longer strangers. You are no longer foreigners or strangers. Simply saying, you are not a temporary dweller. You are not without settled habitation in this place where you exist. You are no longer foreigner. You are no longer stranger. Remember that this letter was addressed to a community where they were very fond of making that sharp distinction between Jews and Gentiles. This distinction was recognized by them. The distinction was encouraged by them. And so belongingness in this context was related to nationality. Belongingness in this context was about birthright. It is here that the images come true to them. You are no longer foreigners. You are no longer strangers. Remember that this letter was written in a context where citizenship was highly valued across the Roman Empire. So much so that among those who regarded themselves as foreigners, foreign to the empire, foreign to the those conquered by Rome, some would pay a great price, large sums of money, in order to obtain citizenship. Talking about Rome way back then. Do you recall that incident in Acts chapter 22, where Paul was bound and was about to be flogged? And as he was about to be flogged, he confronted his captors with the fact that I am a Roman-born citizen, and flogging me would be a crime. And you remember the response of the tribune, the soldier, who was amazed and confessed that, imagine, you are born Roman, and I had to pay a very high price to be a citizen. So we are talking about a context in which citizenship, yes, carried its privileges, but it was highly valued within this context. It is in this situation that St. Paul is saying, you are no longer strangers, sojourners passing through. You are no longer foreigners, one without settled habitation, but instead you are citizen. Now, it is not much different in our time, being a citizen of the empire, and in particular an empire that exists to the north of us. It is still premium for many, and there are some countries in the world, well, last I checked, there was about 30 of them who were willing to sell you citizenship, to sell you citizenship. They have implemented a program called Citizenship by Investment. And many of these countries exist within the Caribbean, within the Eastern Caribbean. And in short, what they're saying is that if you have money, if you can make a large investment, you are welcome to be a citizen of our land and our country. If you have large sums of money, you are welcome. A friend of mine from Jamaica who has been working in a country, one of the colonies that exist in the Caribbean, was granted citizenship because of his valuable contribution to the development of the land, because of his tremendous contribution. His worth was recognized and he was rewarded with citizenship. So if you have extraordinary ability, there is a place for you. If you are ordinary, I'm so sorry, there is no place for you. Because citizenship says you belong. You are not a sojourner. You have bestowed on you certain rights and certain privileges. And these rights and privileges are meant to maintain your dignity and will enrich your lives. Citizenship says you are entitled to some things, and if you're not a citizen, then you are not entitled. It is within this understanding that St. Paul says to our community, those left out, those regarded as Gentiles and therefore having no birthright, those regarded as foreigners and not a part of the privileged empire, it is to that community that St. Paul says, here is a new reality for you. Your relationship with God in Christ now enables us to declare that you are a citizen of a kingdom greater than the Roman Empire. You're a citizen of the kingdom of God. And here you have this, all the privileges bestowed on you, not because of your ability, not because of your resources, not because of nationality, not because of birthright, but simply by the grace of God, which bestows on you this sense of belongingness. We belong. And that's what baptism says, my brothers and sisters. Baptism says we belong. And our belongingness is not based on birthright. Our belongingness is not related to economic status. Our belongingness is not dependent upon our merit, what we have and what we can do or what we don't have and what we cannot do. And it is not restricted by our gender. It is not restricted by our age. It is not restricted by whatever stage we are in life. It is not earned, at least not by us. It is freely given by the grace of God, motivated by the love of God. Baptism brings us and incorporates us into the body of Christ, the family of believers, and it makes an important statement. It says, we belong. We have a place. We have bestowed upon us the privileges that we have received from, by, and through the grace of God. We need always to remember that we are no longer foreigners or strangers. We are not aliens, but we belong, citizens, members of the household of God. That is who you are, my sisters. That is who we are, my brothers and my sisters. We belong. And here's the beauty. None of us I don't know how to put this. None of us have more belonging than the other. None of us belong more than the other. Remember that story told to us in the Gospels about the workers who went out to work, and some went early and some went late. At the end of the day, they all received the same reward. That is perhaps a reminder to us that there is a kind of equality. There is equity within the kingdom of God. And all of us belong. All have equal standing. All have equal status. And all are called to share in this general sense of belongingness. Yes, Candice and Jacqueline and Cara, you belong. You belong. When you go through the waters of baptism today, that's the statement you're making. A statement that you have a place. You have a place in the heart and in the kingdom of God. But I want to explore it a little further, just a little further, to explore this expression a little further. The statement says, we belong. We have a place. We have a right. And that we are recipients of a great privilege bestowed on us by grace, motivated by the love of God. But let me take it further, and perhaps I'm stretching it a little bit, oversimplifying it, but you forgive me. We do not simply belong to an organization. We belong, and here's how I'd want to put it. We belong, and we belong to God. We belong to God. Why am I putting it this way? This underlines the priority of our relationship with God in and through Jesus Christ. Listen to the text. Paul changed the metaphor, and he had a habit of doing that. He says, consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Notice the change, and maybe if he had Jamaican English teachers, they would perhaps charge him for mixing metaphors. The change is from alien, from citizenship, to now construction. So he talks about foundation, and he talks about cornerstone. The recipients of the letter would be aware of and would be familiar with the use of cornerstone. They would know a little bit about the purpose of cornerstone. They would know something about the place of cornerstone. They would understand that the cornerstone was the first one on the construction site. And it was the cornerstone that would set the pattern for the building. All the other stones must line up with the cornerstone if the building is to have integrity. If the stones are not lined up with the cornerstone, the building could be compromised, and there is a possibility that it might not stand. So when St. Paul, in talking to this divided community, in describing for them this new reality of what it means to be a part of this household of God, when he says to them, we belong, he is also saying, not just that you have a place, but we belong to God in Christ. It means this, that our relationship with God through Christ must be a priority in our life. Our relationship with God through Christ must be a priority in and through our lives. Christ is the cornerstone. Christ is the standard for our lives, and that we are called upon to align our lives to the will and purpose of God revealed to us in and through Jesus Christ. Christ is the standard, and Christ also sets the standards. He leads, and we are called upon to follow. Baptism, my sisters, my brothers and sisters, make that statement. That is the statement that you will make as we go through the waters of baptism. We die to self and live. Live to Christ, live for Christ. So we are no longer our own. We are bought with a price. We no longer live for ourselves or by our own abilities or desires. We live in accordance with the will and purpose of God. Baptism makes that statement. We die to self, that God, through Jesus Christ, is priority and primary focus of our lives. Baptism not only makes that statement, we make a pledge in our baptism. We make a pledge to live for Christ, and we also make a pledge to live in Christ. It is not just for you, Candice, Jacqueline, and Cara. It is for all of us gathered here. We have this opportunity to renew our vows. And we have this opportunity to take stock of our lives, to see if we have been living up to our vows, the vows we made when we went through the waters of baptism. Can we truly say, by the way we have been living over these past years or days or weeks, can we truly say that Christ is priority in our lives? That Christ is the center of our lives? That our lives are aligned to the will and purpose of God, and that we deliberately ensure that we align our lives, our thoughts, our ambitions, our purpose, we align it all to the will and purpose of God? Can we truly say that? If we can't, we do have this wonderful opportunity this morning to renew our vows, our commitment, as we witness our sisters go through the waters of baptism. We have this opportunity to once again say, we belong to God, not our own, to the true and living God. We serve no other gods, not the Roman Empire or any other empire in our contemporary times, not our own desires. We serve the true and living God, and we have this opportunity to ensure that our lives can be aligned with the will and purpose of God. So we belong. We have a place. We have a place. We belong to God. We have a purpose. But let me close with this. The statement, description, the summary that St. Paul offers that we believe baptism mirrors is helping us also to understand that yes, we belong, we have a place and a right to that place. We belong to God. Our relationship with God in Christ is priority, but the writer further amplifies it, and we can say it in this way, that we belong to each other. We belong with each other. We belong with each other. Here are the words written for us in verse 22. And in him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. What the verse is doing for us is this. It is highlighting something for us. It is underlining the interrelatedness of the entire structure that makes up the household of God. It is saying that in this household of God, all barriers are removed. All that prevents us from relating to each other, from communing with each other, they have all been removed. So there are no longer any issue about nationality, separation between Jews and Gentiles. All have been reconciled with God, and having been reconciled with God, we are reconciled with each other. So in this household, all are citizens. None are strangers. none are sojourners. The privilege of citizenship is no longer a power that you have to wield over others. Think about the Roman Empire and what it means to be a citizen. It gives you privileges. It gives you access. It gives you power to wield over others and to show that you have an advantage over the other. That's what power, the power that came with that citizenship meant. But St. Paul is saying, this citizenship that you now have in the kingdom of God will not give you power over. Instead, it will give you power with. It will give you power with, and it will also give you power for. So whatever privilege you have is not for you. It is a privilege, a grace given by God to be used for the glory of God. Just think about Paul later on, writing in 1 Corinthians 12 or in Romans 12, and later on in this very book in Ephesians 4, when he's talking about the body of Christ, how he makes that point, that whatever privilege we have, each one has been given a gift. For what? For the benefit of all. Not for self. Not for self. Not for a personal privilege or personal benefit. Each one has been given a gift for the benefit of all. So it is that we belong to each other. And that is a statement saying that we are called upon to partner with each other for the glory of God and to be engaged in the mission of God. It is not power over. It is power with, and it is power for. As we belong to each other, it is a reminder that we share a partnership in Christ. That, when you read it carefully, you get a sense that though he's using the metaphor of a building, that the building is under construction, and there's a sense that the building is growing together. The building is growing, and you know that it is buildings do grow, I imagine, in some way. And but the idea that he conveyed is that we are all a work in progress. We are all under construction. We are all working together as we try to help each other. And by helping each other, we are ensuring that the building, this household of faith, this household is truly being what God intends it to be. So what is the reminder? Simply that we are called upon to work together. We are called upon to work for each other. We are called upon to help one another. That's the family, my sisters and brothers, my sisters, that you are about to come into. That's what the family at its best ought to be. Working not for ourselves, but for each other, seeking and working for the best of each other. That's the task, the mission being entrusted to you as we become part of this household, working for the benefit of this household, for the glory and honor of God. It's a reminder to us, my sisters and brothers, those who have been here a little bit longer, those who have had a little bit more experience, that our experience and our being here a little bit longer is not a power to use over others. Say, so you just come, you don't know this place or know this thing. Me there a long time, you know from when me there? It is not about that. It is to say, I have a little bit more knowledge, more experience in life, and that is a gift I have received from God that I will use to help you to be better. Because when you are better, all of us are better. Why? We belong with each other, and we belong to each other. It is not a privilege to use over others, to use with, and to use for. My sisters, when you go through the waters of baptism today, you are becoming members of the household of God. The household of God, of which Bethel is only a small part, a little dot, in this large household of God, this universal church. We talk about the church militant, the church on earth, present in many and every corner of the world.
You are becoming a part of the church triumphant, the church that exists in all ages and all times, the church in heaven and the church on earth. We belong together. Here is a challenge I would like to throw out to you, if you are here present or listening to us. A reminder I would like to issue to you. The reminder is this. Remember, you belong. You belong to God. And you belong, we belong together. Perhaps you were once a part of the church, engaged in the ministries of the church, but for some reason, you have wandered away. Can I remind you it's time to come home? Because there is a place at the table for you. You belong. Your place is still there. It was never taken. Your chair was never removed. Your room was never given to anybody else. There is always a place for you as long as you accept that it is time for you to come home. It is time for some of us who have drifted away from the family, wandered away from the household. It is time to come home. Here is a message being proclaimed by three sisters, including one very young one, to you today. It is time. It is time to come home. Reading the words of Paul, written for us in Ephesians 2, 19 to 21, where St. Paul was describing, offering a description of this new community where people who were once opposed to each other, once antagonistic with each other, once bitter enemies, are reconciled by grace into this household of God. And he used familiar metaphors to help them to understand what this new community is about and what it is expected of them. And we, in trying to interpret it, have offered some feeble words to help us to understand. We belong. There is a place for all. A place given to us and bestowed on us, not because of nationality or ability or anything about ourselves, but simply by the grace of God, motivated by the love of God. We belong. We have a place. We belong to God, cornerstone, the chief cornerstone. Our relationship with God must be priority for all of us. Our lives must be aligned with the will and purpose of God. And we belong together. We are called upon and called by God. God, in God's wisdom, chose us and brought us together. Different backgrounds, different understanding, different temperaments. We like each other sometimes. We can't stand each other at other times. But God brought us together in God's own will and providence. Simply because, to remind us, we belong together. We are partners in God's mission. We work together. We work for each other. And we rise or fall together. My brothers and sisters, that is the beauty of the household of God. It says to all of us, wherever we are, wherever we are from, we belong. We belong to God, and we belong with each other. Amen. Let's make a promise to God. The promise that our sisters will make in a few minutes from now, as they enter the waters of baptism, the promise to serve Jesus to the very end. Let us renew that promise. Those of us who have been baptized, let's renew that promise to serve Jesus to the end. And if you are here and you have never made that promise, here is a wonderful opportunity we offer to you on this day, to make that promise, to make that pledge. Oh Jesus, I have promised to serve you to the end. Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend. If you are here and you have never made that promise, we want to issue an invitation to you. There is a place. You belong. You belong. there is a place here for you in the kingdom of God, among the people of God, as part of the family and the household of God. There is a place for you. So as we sing, I would like to invite you to come as a way of saying, I am acknowledging that there is a place for me, and I have come now to take my place. If you are here and you were once a part of this household, but somehow you have drifted away, your place is still here, still here. No condemnation, no quarrel. That's how God works. No question, just glad to see you come back. If you are here and that is your desire, as we sing, come so we can pray with you and pray for you. The hymn, O Jesus, I Have Promised. That dazzle.
I see the stars that dazzle.
Tempting sounds I hear.
The tempting sounds I hear. My walls are ever near me.
Around me and within.
Around me and within. But Jesus draw thou nearer and shield my soul from sin.
Let us pray. O Jesus, you have promised to all who follow you that where you are in glory, there shall your servants be. And Jesus, we have promised to serve you to the end. We ask you, we beg of you, to give us the grace to follow you, our master and our friend. Amen. Please be seated. My sisters and brothers, we had the privilege last week, Wednesday, and the week before to listen to our sisters testify, give verbal witness to their relationship with God in Christ. Our sisters Candice Blake, Jacqueline Knight, and Cara Joy Reed,
invite them to come now and to stand before us so we can pray for them as a family of believers. And the sponsors, if you are present, come and stand with them. My sisters and brothers, let's remind ourselves, let us recall what we understand to be the meaning of baptism. In baptism, we become one with Christ in his death and resurrection. We become one with Christ. It is a confession of faith. A confession of faith, which is a statement of our loyalty to Jesus Christ. We are declaring that we are loyal to Jesus Christ. Through baptism, we become members of the church, not just Little Bethel, but members of the church, the body of Christ. The washing of our bodies with water is a sign of the cleansing of our whole life and our whole personality by the Spirit of God. In baptism, we mark the receiving of the Holy Spirit, who has brought us to this moment of commitment and who will strengthen us for all our future work, our future endeavor. The Spirit brought us here, and the Spirit will continue to journey with us. Our baptism is symbolic of our receiving that Holy Spirit. So my sisters, you have testified that you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and that you now intend to follow Christ, follow the Christian way of life. And as a result, you are here to be baptized. Before God and the church, I put the following questions to you, which we invite you to respond to. These are the commitments you are making to God in the presence of the church this day. In presenting yourself for baptism, do you confess your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Do you promise, in dependence on divine grace, to follow Christ and to serve him forever in the fellowship of his church? Members of the Bethel Baptist Church gathered here and in other places, do you receive these candidates for baptism and pledge your support to them that they may be encouraged and inspired to live the Christian life and to grow in grace and in the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ our Lord? If this is your affirmation, please indicate by standing. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we thank you that in Jesus Christ you revealed yourself to our sisters as you have to all of us, and you brought them to salvation and to redemption. We thank you for every means which you use to strengthen our faith, and especially for the sacraments of baptism. Hear us on behalf of your servants, your daughters, who are now about to be baptized. We thank you for their decision to follow you. And we thank you for the courage given to them by your Spirit to make this public declaration of their salvation. So we ask you, O God, to pour out afresh upon them your Holy Spirit, to keep them to the very end, that you hold them in the palm of your hand, and may not one be snatched away from you, that you nurture them day by day
surrounding them with a community that will encourage and nurture, that you will cause them to have access and knowledge of your grace, of your love, of your forgiveness, of your provision day by day. Bless our sisters, O God, and bless all of us as we come to you in Jesus' name. Amen. My sisters, let us prepare ourselves now to be baptized.
Okay, before the baptism, we'll sing the first two verses of the hymn, Happy Day. Verse 3.
Now rest my long divided heart, fixed on this blissful center rest. There have I found a nobler part, heavenly pleasures fill my heart.
Candice Blake.
Sister Candice, upon the profession of your repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you into the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Jacqueline Knight.
Jacqueline, upon the profession of your repentance towards God and your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Cara Joy Reed.
Cara Joy, Joy Joy, upon the profession of your repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, we now baptize you into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, there continues to be a place for you, a place in the kingdom, a place around the table, a place for you. You belong. You belong to God, and you belong to the household of faith, to the people of God. I wonder if you are here and you have never made that declaration, that commitment. We want to give you the opportunity to invite you to come to talk with us so we can be of service to you, help you in this walk of faith. May God grant you the strength, and may God enable you to respond to the prompting of the Spirit in your life and to respond to this call to take your place, the place where you belong.
We'll sing the third and fourth verse of Happy Days. The fruit of the Spirit includes kindness and generosity, gifts of God we enjoy. At this time, I invite the ushers to wait on us for our tithes and offering. let us pray. O God, we know you to be kind and generous, so we bring our gifts in gratitude and joy. As we present our offering, may the Spirit fill us with generosity and multiply our kindness for the sake of Christ, our living Lord. Amen. Please stand for the doxology.
Great God, from whom blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below, praise Him above the heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Now approach the throne of grace with our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Let us join our hearts and minds in prayer. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So we lift our hearts up to you, God, in praise and thanksgiving. God of mystery and mercy, God of our past and our future, as we count our blessings and acknowledge your goodness, we present all our hopes and dreams, the burdens and blessings of our lives. We come seeking your comfort, strength, listening for your guidance. In your love, you have called us to know you, led us to trust you. and bound our life with yours. Today we pray specially for our three sisters who were baptized. Lord, we're immensely grateful for your soul-saving power. It is our prayer that as fellow brothers and sisters, we will lead lives that will only guide these three sisters closer to you, dear Lord. God of life and love, you engage us in the midst of our lives when we need you. We pray today for all those who feel fearful about their future, and for all who wrestle with challenges at work or at home. We remember before you those weighed down by illness or worry, and all who provide care for those in need of support. Help each one of us to face our fears and challenges, supported by your love. God of courage and comfort, whenever we wrestle with any burden, your spirit prays within us with sighs too deep for words. Today we pray for all those whose burdens seem far too heavy to bear. We remember our members and friends on our prayer list, those that have lost loved ones, those ill and hospitalized, or those recuperating at home. For victims of violence or disaster, and for the friends and for their friends and families. For refugees at risk in so many places in the world, especially those who have fled Ukraine and now Afghanistan. We pray those caught in despair and poverty in Jamaica and in our own community, as well as those persons in the forgotten corners of your world. Renew the strength of all those challenged by realities beyond their control. Lord, we're confident that the abundance of our harvest is a symbol of the abundance of your love in our life. May we live in a spirit of gratitude to you and generosity to our neighbors. Loving God, in this season and all year long, give to us the gift of a thankful heart, so that we may acknowledge you as the giver of all that is good in our lives. In your name we pray, asking, Amen. Okay. As we prepare for to feast together in Holy Communion, we will sing, I Have Found a New Life.
Brothers and sisters, we will now receive Candice Blake, Jacqueline Knight, and Cara Joy Reed to the membership of the Bethel Baptist Church. By this act of reception, we shall enter into a covenant with them, even as we renew our own covenant with God. That covenant that we enter with them and with the Lord and with each other is to share with each other in building up the church to the glory of God. We will work alongside one another in God's service in the world and encouraging one another in the love of God. Jesus said, "Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven." Jesus said, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture." My sisters, in your baptism, you were received into the fellowship of Christ, sealed as members of the family, of the household of God, and you vowed to live a new life in obedience to the will of Christ, and you now come to be a part of this fellowship. You desire to live worthily of the gospel of Christ, whose name you bear, to learn of him and to show forth God's praise, not only with your lips, but with your life. I now put these questions to you and invite you to respond with "I do." Do you declare your faith in the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, having found a new life in him? Do you believe that God has called you to serve Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit as a part of this, the Bethel Baptist Church? Will you be constant in prayer, faithful in your study of scriptures, regular in your attendance at worship, contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the church and to the spread of the gospel? Members of the Bethel Baptist Church family, do you welcome our sisters Candice, Jacqueline, and Cara into the family of God in this local church? If you agree, please say, "We do." Do you promise to love, encourage, strengthen, guide, pray for, and care for them as equal partners in the body of Christ? Can hardly hear you. Thank you. Loving God, we believe you have guided your children to be a part of this family. And we use this opportunity, all of us, to renew the vows that they have taken. We have taken it upon ourselves as our own. And we are renewing those vows to you now, to be faithful in prayer and in the reading of scriptures, constant in your study of the scriptures, regular in our attendance at worship, and to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the growth and development of your church. Help all of us to work together to honor you in all that we do. This we pray in Jesus' name. Sister Candice, Jacqueline, and Cara, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and on behalf of this, the Bethel Baptist Church, we welcome you into this family, and I will extend the right hand or elbow of fellowship as a token of your acceptance, your presence as members of this congregation. You certainly sound happy to receive them as part of the fellowship. Shall we stand then and sing, "You're My Brother, You're My Sister"? And though you're not able to touch them, you can at least look at point. Let us prepare our hearts as we share together in the Holy. Let us call to mind the meaning of this great supper. We gather in thanksgiving to God for the great sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary for our salvation. We receive this Holy Communion as a reminder for what God has done, for what God is doing, and what God will do. Reminding ourselves that we are one in Christ because we eat of the same bread and drink of the same cup. Reminding ourselves that when all of life comes to an end, the word of Jesus to his disciples, "You will not eat and drink with me again till we eat and drink in my Father's kingdom." A reminder of our continued nurture and preparation to feast in God's kingdom, to spend eternity with God. Though now we see through a glass dimly, but we shall behold him face to face. An opportunity for us to renew the vows that we made at our baptism. Each time we receive this bread and wine, we are renewing that vow and that commitment. We are receiving Christ afresh in our hearts and in our lives, feasting on him. And as a community, the corporate body here gathered, allowing Christ to break us and distribute us for the benefit of the world. Take a moment and offer your own prayers of thanks to God for this great sacrament, what it means to us about what Christ has done for us. here now with the invitation. If you truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and are resolved to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking henceforth in his holy ways, then draw near with faith and take this sacrament for our comfort and our growth in grace. We come to this sacred table not because we must, but because we may. We come not to testify that we are righteous, but that we sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciples. We come not because we are strong, but because we are weak, and in our frailty and sin, we stand in constant need of heaven's mercy and heaven's help. In our worship, we offered our confessions to God, and we know that we are not worthy even to gather the crumbs under his table. But God is merciful, and God is just, and God has forgiven us of our sins and cleansed us from all our unrighteousness. And so we stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. And we are grateful that it is not any merit on our own, but by God's grace that we can receive Christ afresh and feed on the Spirit in our hearts. I am the bread of life, Jesus told them. Eat of me, and you will never be hungry. I am the living water. Drink, and we shall never thirst. Hear the words of institution taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, words written and captured for us by the Apostle Paul. He wrote, "For I have received from the Lord the teaching I pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. After he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body broken for you. This do in memory of me.' After supper, he took also the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant sealed with my blood. As often as you drink it, this do in memory of me.'" It means that every time we eat the bread and drink from the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let everyone, therefore, examine him or herself first, then eat the bread and drink from the cup. The Lord Jesus, the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. This do in memory of me." After supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant sealed with my blood. As often as you drink it, this do in memory of me." In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who instituted the sacrament of his body and blood, we set apart these emblems of bread and of wine. We set them apart to the holy use to which they have been appointed. As he gave thanks, we'll ask our deacon brother, Jimmy Thorpe, to offer the prayer of thanksgiving for the bread and the wine.
Let us pray. Wonderful, merciful Father, precious Redeemer and friend, who could have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, loving Father, we thank you for your great love for us, a love that caused you to offer up your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the sacrificial lamb, to go to Calvary, to die a criminal's death, to purchase our redemption. And so, Lord, as we draw around your table now, we thank you for the word that has been proclaimed, reminding us of our togetherness, of our belongingness to you. And so, Lord, we're reminded, Lord, that we are invited by you to partake of what you have, of what we shall receive today. And as we celebrate your love, Lord, we give thanks for the emblems which we'll partake of. The bread reminding us, Lord, of your battered and abused body. The wine symbolizing, Lord, your lifeblood flowing from your body at Calvary. And so, Lord, as we eat and as we drink, we ask that you would give us a special sense of your presence. Indeed, Lord, we thank you for the blessing that this service has been to us today. And so, Lord, when we shall have finished, Lord, help us to leave here with a renewed determination to be your faithful servants, being your agents of kindness, compassion, and Lord, help us to be your mouthpiece, reaching out to the lost. So bless us today, Lord, as we celebrate your love with these emblems. We ask all these mercies in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
The hymn, "I Am the Bread of Life."
Who believes? we are not our own, bought with a price. So we glorify God with our bodies. This table says we belong to God, belong with each other for the glory of God. Christ died for our redemption, and this is our reminder. The body of Christ broken for you. Eat in remembrance of him and be thankful. The blood of Christ shed for you. Drink ye all of it and be thankful. There is a prayer recorded in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 to 21, prayer for the church, which I pray on our behalf. Let us pray. Prayer of St. Paul's for the church. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we all ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Offer a prayer for the person beside you, on your left and on your right. Offer a prayer for someone who asked you to do that when you were on your way here today. Thank you, Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts, for enabling us to be in your presence, for renewing us, for strengthening us, and for empowering us to serve you. We commit our ways to you, and we pledge to be faithful to you always. This we pray in Jesus' name. The cups are going to be retrieved and an offering taken, a benevolent offering received. As we do that, we'll sing, "I Just Want to Follow Jesus." Thank you.
to follow Jesus, follow each and every day, and I want to praise and serve Him as I walk a narrow way. Where He leads me, I will follow. Stay with Him forever. He's my dearest, dearest friend. I just want to follow Jesus, follow each and every day, and I want to praise and serve Him as I walk the narrow way. Start until the end. I will stay with Him forever. He's my nearest, dearest friend. I just want to follow Jesus, follow each and every day. I want to praise and serve Him as I walk the narrow way.
Stand for the benediction. We are grateful to all who have joined us for worship today, and we trust that God's Spirit will continue to be with you, encourage you, and enable you to go forth in this week ahead and in the days to come. Remember to greet our sisters who are newly baptized before you run off. And may God's grace. Go forth to the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Help the weak. Support the afflicted. Honor all of God's children. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. So may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with all of us and with all of God's children everywhere, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.